And a good Wednesday evening to you. Welcome into 102.5 The Game. And as you heard, MMA tonight. Darren McFarland, Chris Pappas. No Ed Clay this evening.
Where is Ed?
Ed is on the road. Again. On the road again.
All right.
Not with Willie Nelson. That's not who he's, whose tour bus he's on.
No, it's not.
Thank goodness for him. That's good news. Parker behind the glass, man in the dials for the next hour. We'll talk mixed martial arts with you. We're excited about this. We do this every Wednesday on the program following Slapshot Radio. After the first segment, we will come back with Brendan Schaub, who will be on the 157 card this weekend in Anaheim, where we begin this discussion, because the main event, Chris Pappas, is a women's bantamweight fight, which will have Ronda Rousey and Liz Carmouche, I guess is how you say it, in Anaheim at the Honda Center. And it's the first time, obviously, ever the UFC has had two women finish out the night, finish out a card, and that's going to happen.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's the first fight.
Right, ever. Ever. Right. So, nobody's ever had a women's card finish out. Any strike force, you know, any of the levels that we've seen actually come through here.
Well, it's a tough spot for Ronda, and you know, I'm a big fan of Ronda's. You know, just her personality, her style, you know, just everything about her. It's hard not to really like her. You know, even though I do think that if Cyborg fought her, that she would lose. But you know, that's obviously debatable. But she's in a tough spot because people are going to there are some people that are going to think that the way I look at pay-per-view fights is this: is the main card worth headlining a pay-per-view event? And for this fight, although I'm a big fan of Rousey's, I don't think it is. Not because I don't like her, but because she's going to destroy this girl very quickly. It's similar that if you had Anderson Silva fighting Stephen Bonner, like he did, that's not a quality main event fight, because it's just, you know, it's a very, very small chance that someone like Bonner or Carmouche could defeat, you know, Ronda or Anderson Silva. So, you know, it's frustrating from a fan standpoint, because the only fight that we want to see in female MMA is Rousey and Cyborg, and they couldn't work out the weight and all this kind of stuff. That's a whole nother debate. So it'll be interesting to see, but she's in a tough spot, because if it does well, people are going to say, well, it does well because Dan Henderson and Machida, you know, pulled the numbers, which is very, very possible.
Cause that's, sure.
That's the fight that I think I want to see the most. I mean,
I think most do.
Sure. And if it doesn't do well, then they'll say, well, it's because Ronda was a headliner, which could be true. So she's almost in a you know, a tough
spot.
She's
in a no-win situation.
Right. So, but, you know, it's great for the sport. You know, there was a good story yesterday that Dan Wetzel wrote on Yahoo about when Dana told Ronda that she was coming into the UFC. And, you know, he brought her to dinner, and she didn't know why. They had just a big dinner set up with a lot of people. And he pulled her aside, and he said, Ronda, do you know why I took you to this restaurant here in Beverly Hills? And she said, no. And he said, it was a year ago today that TMZ right outside asked me if there would ever be women fighting in the UFC. And I said, never. No, ever, never. He said, I'm here tonight to tell you that I was wrong. And you're going to be the first one. So, wow. You know, it's certainly a step.
I hope she pulled out a recorder.
Yeah.
Not too many times does he say that.
Well, I mean, it's a, you know, I think MMA, female, women's MMA, compared to a lot of other sports, has a chance to really have a decent audience compared to the men. You know, typically in sports, except for maybe soccer, you know, or tennis, It's tougher, you know, with the major sports, you know, basketball, you know, softball, things like that. But I think, you know, the girls in MMA can draw fans, especially if the fights are exciting. And you know, fighters like Ronda, fighters like Cyborg, like Gina Carano, you know, those are fun, exciting fighters to watch. You know, and Gina Carano's not going to fight again ever, I doubt. I mean, she's doing movies. You know, so the only fight really that I want to see right now is the Cyborg-Rousey fight. And that's the big problem that they have, is that there's not a lot of fights to be made. There's not a lot of talent. And that was Dana's whole Well, that was part of Dana's reasoning why he would not have women fight in the UFC. And, you know, that's still true. You know, I don't know the division as well maybe as I should, but I'm not sure of any fighters besides Cyborg that I think would be a good fight with Ronda Rousey. Now, look, Liz Cambage could come out and surprise a lot of people, but, you know, she's only beaten two people that have winning records. And, you know, in a division that's not that strong. So it'd be a miracle in the octagon type moment.
Speaking of, let's do this. Parker, I'm going to spring this on you. I haven't even told you what I'm about to do. Chris has no idea what we're doing.
I never do.
I know. That's what's fun about this. Since we're talking about UFC 157 this Saturday, and as we brought up, Ronda Rousey, Liz Carmouche, I just like saying it that way. You have Lyoto Machida and Dan Henderson. Mm-hmm. Uriah Faber is on this card. It's going to be a really good card. Court McGee, Josh Koscheck, Robbie Lawler, Brendan Schaub, who we will have on in the next segment. He's fighting LeVar Johnson. We'll talk to him. But it starts at 9 o'clock our time, correct? Yep. So you need to make sure that you call up whoever your outlet is or your provider,
right,
and get the fight because it's this Saturday, UFC 157, and this is what we'll do. UFC 139, Parker, we've got it on DVD. It was the one with Shogun, Rua, and Hendo. Vanderlei Silva was on there. Uriah Faber was on there. Martin Kampmann was on there. Stefan Bonner. Good card, if you remember. UFC 139. We've got it on DVD. Parker, first person to pick up the phone and dial 737-1025. 737-1025. We'll find out how many MMA fans are out there listening to the show. You will receive a copy of UFC 139. It's that easy. I mean, all you have to do is dial.
Are you going to sign it?
Easy enough.
No, I'm not going to sign it. That doesn't enhance anything.
No, I'm saying people wouldn't call in then, so I just wanted to make sure.
Well, I was going to say, why would you try to make it more difficult? Yeah, no. No, we're just going to give you a copy of UFC 139 just by picking up the phone and dialing 737-1025.
Yeah.
But getting back to this card, you do wonder. This is the struggle with this division and with the women. Just once you get the dominant woman fighter, Chris, it's okay, who else is out there available? If she goes through, there's usually one or two really, really good matches, and if she goes through that and nobody's left, then what do you do? It's tough to make that work.
Yeah, I mean, until, you know, I feel that Cyborg, you know, she went to Invicta. You know, Dana even came out and said that he offered to send her there, almost like sending someone to the minor leagues, and he would pay the purse and then let her come back, and she didn't want to do that for some reason. I think she'll fight her three fights in Invicta, and sometime early next year we'll agree to go down to the 135 weight class and fight Ronda if she can. I mean, she's a big girl, and I don't know if she can do it, but there's really no fights that I can see that are really exciting for me. The only thing I think they could do next for Ronda is let her fight the girl that she fought before that she broke
that
her
she
arm.
Keeps right I, ripping I off her limbs.
Yeah, oh, Misha Tate. You know, because Misha, of all the fighters, has taken Ronda the longest in the first round. You know, almost got through a whole first round. Actually, did some good things striking. I mean, good things, you know, meaning that she did kind of land a couple. So, I mean, I guess they could make that fight again. You know, it wouldn't be a main event fight. It'd be more of a on-the-card kind of fight. But they really need to, you know, and listen, I'm not an expert at all on women's MMA, and there could be fighters out there in gyms I have no clue about that could do well. But I don't know of them. And so, you know, we'll see. I'm intrigued to watch it. I wouldn't buy this pay-per-view just for this fight, but I typically don't buy a pay-per-view for just one fight anyway.
And that's the beauty of the UFC. They usually make 3, 4, five really attractive cards.
Yeah, and what's fun about Ronda is almost like watching John Jones kind of progress, because, you know, what Ronda's good at is judo. And you know what John Jones was really good at was Greco wrestling, and things like that. It's fun to watch young fighters like this progress in their striking, because you know Ronda's striking is very limited, or was very limited. But you know she's had another 6-7 months to put in the gym, and she's a hard worker. It'd be fun to see what her striking's like, because if her striking gets better, then it gives her a better portfolio to utilize her judo throws, because right now she uses a little short jab to kind of get in close and wrap and throw. And you know someone like Cyborg or even Gina Carano, who has very high level striking, you know, could hurt her doing that. So it'd be fun to see what she's learned and kind of how she's progressed, because Liz Carmouche is gonna, you know, is certainly gonna throw some stuff. I mean, she likes flying knees and spinning back fists and a lot of crazy stuff. So it'll be fun to see. But my guess is she'll try to throw something and get taken down, and she'll be tapping.
Congratulations to David Knight of Nashville. We do have some MMA fans out there, Pappas. We had loaded lines, and be listening this hour. There may be more times for you to win copies of UFC 139. So congratulations to David in Nashville. He was the first to jump in there before they loaded up, and he's the winner of UFC 139. When we come back, Brendan Schaub, he will be on the card Saturday night in Anaheim. He is going to be fighting LeVar Johnson. Brendan Schaub, if you remember, was on The Ultimate Fighter. We'll get into a lot of discussions with him next as you listen to MMA Tonight right here on 102.5 The Game. Back here on MMA Tonight, 102.5 The Game, 8:16 is the time. Darren McFarlane, Chris Pappas here in our game studios. Ed Clay, excuse me, off for the week. He's out traveling. He'll be back with us next week. It was good to catch up with Benson Henderson last week. Really good interview, good guy, and a fun guy to talk to.
Yeah, absolutely. He's always fun to talk to.
And an exciting guy to watch.
A little bit.
In the octagon.
A little bit.
This guy is also exciting.
Those little guys are fun.
Yeah, well, and the big guys are too.
That's right.
That's why we always gravitate to the heavyweights. And on the line with us is Brendan Schaub. He joins us here on MMA Tonight. Brendan, how you doing?
I'm doing great, guys. What's going on?
How you doing? Where are you out in you're out in California right now?
Yeah, I'm in the OC right now in Anaheim here in my hotel.
Getting ready. So what is it like, you know, when you're scheduled to – I've always wondered, you know, when you start preparing for a fighter and you get your game plan together and you're going through your training and they get injured and they have to pull out and delay it and you have to wait a couple more months, what is that like? How much does that affect the other guy?
Yeah, you know, it's frustrating to say the least bit. You know, for me, not much changes. You know, I live in L.A. full-time, and I do my camps in Denver. So as far as financially, you know, you go through a whole camp, and, you know, they're not cheap. So as far as financially, it's going to cost some bucks, you know, especially if you're doing a camp back-to-back. But it's just time away from my home here in L.A. And as far as camp goes, it's such a loose term, especially with fighters these days. For me, it's a lifestyle, so I'm always training. So, you know, but let's say Saturday night the fight goes as planned and I win and come out uninjured, I'll be back to training Monday. So there really is no camp for me. I'm always training.
Wow. You know, I want to pick your brain about some things before we delve into your fight on Saturday night, just because you've now participated and been a part as a professional of both sports. And we had, what was it, Sean Jordan, Chris, a couple weeks ago?
Yeah.
Won a national championship at LSU, was a football player, and then, of course, made transition over to this sport, just like yourself. You played a lot of football, and now you're in the UFC. And I want to know, sure, from a guy who's participated at the highest levels in both sports and all the awareness and everything that we're talking about now on the football side, are you a little worried, and what do you think they can do about safety? And, you know, we're talking about CTE and concussions. I mean, what's your feelings from a guy that's experienced both?
You know, I think it's man, that's such a loaded question.
Yeah.
Right? It's a million-dollar question with the NFL right now. With the UFC, you know, it's not such an issue because, you know, guys that suffer a knockout or TKO and they take time off. They're suspended and they're forced to take time off. With the NFL, you know, these guys are banging each other around, and then, you know, the next week, you know, they're getting, what, 6 days off?
Yeah.
You know, if they're lucky, they're getting 6 days off, then doing it again. So that's the issue. And the other issue is guys are so big and fast now. And the way defenses are set up with the zone defenses, and you know, I just think it's a problem they're not going to solve. It's something we're always going to have to deal with when it comes to the NFL.
Did you ever think about it when you were playing in the Arena League and the NFL about some of the things we're discussing?
You really don't. You know, I think now guys are more knowledgeable on it, but, you know, I didn't play that long ago, you know, and it really wasn't something you talked about. It was just, you know, I see you playing fullback was kind of a doozy, and I'd get these headaches, and, you know, you just think it's kind of part of the game, and you tough it out. And now I think guys are more aware of it, and, you know, they're going to, if they're smart, they're going to pull themselves out and take a little break. So, I put it on the coaching staff, you know, they want to win the game at by any means necessary, but it's costing some guys their health.
Yeah, I think the days of saying you just got your bell rung are probably over in sports.
Yeah, that doesn't work anymore.
No, it doesn't.
Doesn't really work anymore. I think Junior Seau kind of put that thin.
Yeah, and you know what? I've talked to a lot of guys. I was down in the Super Bowl for a week, talking to a lot of former NFL players, and you know what is sad, and some that played with him were teammates of his, and it's sad to say, but, and I agree with this statement, Junior Seau's death, while tragic and very, very sad, is going to save probably a lot of people's lives.
I agree 100%. You know, it was a horrible thing. He was my childhood hero. He was my favorite player. I wore number 55 because of him, but you know, I think his death can definitely be something positive. I think the Seau family want that, including Junior. So it's a big deal. And, you know, then they gave his brain to research, and I think it's good.
And, you know, you talk about the difference in the NFL or football and MMA, and I think you made a good point about, you know, about how MMA fighters are able to, you know, take time off or are forced to after they get knocked out. And also, I don't think people understand that there's a difference between getting knocked out and having a concussion. You can get knocked out and not have a concussion. And
yeah, for sure. And that's why boxing's so dangerous. Boxing right. is as dangerous as it gets.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, you wonder if sports, you know, other sports could follow the MMA model. You know, if you do suffer a knockout, even though you may not have had a concussion, you know, should these guys mm-hmm. be forced to take 3, 4, 5 months off? I mean, it's a good discussion, and who knows, you know what'll come of it. But let's get to your fight. You know, talking about knockouts, I have a feeling there's going to be a knockout this weekend, if I had to guess. I mean, you guys are both heavy hitters. I think it's going to be a fun fight for the fans, a fun fight on FX. You know, what are your thoughts about LeVar and the matchup?
Yeah, a cool stat someone brought to my attention the other day is between LeVar and myself, we have a 97% finish rate in all of our fights. So,
wow.
You know, I don't know where the judges stay. I was hoping I'd see them around the hotel or something like that, but they can go ahead and take the night off. Or when our fight comes up, they can go grab coffee or tweet or do whatever they want to do, because this one's not going to the judges, I'll tell you that much.
Is it true that the girls have put away the numbers 2 and 3? For your fight, because I don't think we're going to see rounds 2 or 3.
Yeah, they're just handing them 1 and, like, don't even worry about it.
Just take the 1 to the ring.
Just take the 1. Don't worry about the 2 and 3 tonight on this one. But you know what? It's, you know, LeVar, you know, the reason why, you know, I think so many people are excited for this fight and why I've waited for this matchup for quite some time now is, you know, LeVar is probably the heaviest hitter in the heavyweight division, and he fancies himself a striker, and I think I'm better at it, and we're going to find out some Saturday night, and I think it's going to be exciting. I think it'll be the highest ratings yet on FX.
Yeah, it's a great card on FX, and, you know, you're on The Ultimate Fighter, which I think has got some more life into it now, and I forget, who was your coach on The Ultimate Fighter? I forgot.
Mine was Rashad.
It was Rashad, right.
Opposing coach was Rampage.
Yeah. So, you know, we're here in Tennessee, and you know, Rampage is from Memphis. So, we, you know, we do have some love for Rampage around here. But I could tell, and as he had admitted, he was not the biggest fan of being a coach on that show. What was it from your perspective, you know, behind the scenes, seeing Rampage around? I mean, what was he like? Even though I know you were on Rashad's team and didn't see really his coaching sessions, but what was the feeling from some of the other fighters?
I got along with Rampage very well, and I still do to this day when I see him. You know, he's always been a huge supporter of mine. And, you know, some guys are doers and not coaches. You know, they kind of they can do the move, but they can't teach it. They're just so athletically gifted, or to them, it's not easy to explain stuff. I think Rampage is one of those guys, and you don't find out till you're kind of in it. And I think he realized he was one of those guys who is better at kind of going and you know, doing his thing and not being able to coach. So it made for entertaining, you know, TV for people. But and I think that showed we have the highest ratings, you know, of all time on Ultimate Fighter. And I think that's going to be tough to beat. And that's due to Rampage and Rashad and the rest of the cast.
Well, it's perfect because, you know, I think what I expected from this year, between Sonnen and John Jones, we haven't seen yet, was that type of kind of animosity going back and forth, because that makes for great TV, you know? I mean, so maybe we'll see it. But that's the last Ultimate Fighter I really remember really well. And
I'm with you. I haven't really watched one since, and I was a guest coach for last season with Shane Carwin, and I'd even watch that season.
Yeah, how's Shane doing? I was going to ask you that. I know he was injured. Have you been around him, seen him? Is he going to fight again?
Oh, yeah. He's he's a very good friend. He's he's in Greeley. I call him the ogre. He's up there in his swamp with his lady and the kid, and he's had back problems and neck problems, so he's just up there, you know, doing his job, his engineering job, and kind of hoping to get his back better. He's doing rehab and stuff like that. So will he make a comeback? You know, I like to think so.
Brendan Schaub on the line with us here on MMA Tonight, 102.5 The Game. After you lost in the Ultimate Fighter Finals to Roy Nelson, Brendan, you went on a 4-win streak to debut in the UFC. What was that like for you to come out of the gates and to rebound from your first loss as a professional?
My career has been interesting because, you know, I had 3 fights, and then I got put on the Ultimate Fighter, and then so the fans, especially the fans who follow me closely, I've been kind of raised, you know, with all my fights being on TV and being in the spotlight. So, after the Ultimate Fighter, that's when your career begins. And a lot of guys, you know, who lose on the show or lose in the finale thinks their career over, and they have no idea. It's just beginning, and now the real competition begins. So I just looked at it like a tournament, and I finished second in, you know, one of the toughest tournaments in the world, and that's not too shabby. And I still had a UFC contract to rely on, and, you know, went on this 4-fight streak. And then, my last two haven't gone as planned, but, man, when you're winning your fights, you knock everyone out, it's easy. If everyone was going undefeated, you'd just be a bully. It wouldn't be fighting. So for me, I've never worked so hard for a fight, and I'm excited come Saturday night to get back on track.
Are you a guy that learns? You just mentioned you've lost your last two, Big Nog and Ben Rothwell. Are you a guy that tries to learn from mistakes and learn from losses to get better?
That's the only way you learn. You know, when you're winning, I don't even watch the fights back, really. The ones that I win, I just kind of chalk them up as I won, and I carry on to the next guy, the next mission. And you learn the most from your losses. And I don't have a ton of experience, especially the guys that I've been fighting. These guys have 30, 40 fights. LeVar's a more experienced guy than me, so I make up for it with my athletic ability and technique. So, sometimes I can get a little over-aggressive, and it's cost me my last two fights, you know, fighting at a world-class level. Those kind of mistakes are going to cost you dearly. So I've definitely learned from it, and Saturday night it's going to be a different story.
Would you, if the Ultimate Fighter called back again, you know, for you to be a coach, for example, in the coming years, is that something that would interest you? Because you seem like
I would do that in a heartbeat. I'd love to do that.
Yeah, you seem like, you said some guys like to coach and some guys don't. You seem like a guy that would probably like to coach, and kind of like Shane Carwin seemed to really embrace it, and, you know, Chael Sonnen seems to really kind of enjoy, you know, coaching.
I definitely take the opportunity and run with it. I think, there's nothing better you can do than to give back, especially when you see these young up-and-comers and the game's growing so fast. I think it'd be fun.
I have to believe that Brendan beating Krokop and Gonzaga, while, yes, most people feel that they're on the back end of their careers, that had to have been a thrill for you, huh?
Yeah, you know, Krokop was my favorite fighter when I was getting into the game, so he's a hero to me, and getting knocked out of the night against a guy like that is tough to do. And as far as Gonzaga, you know, I think he's won 4 straight, and he's back in the UFC, and he's won his last 2, and he just beat the guy last 2, Ben Rothwell. So to say he's on the downside of his career is crazy to me. So I think that would be the difference come Saturday night, too, you know, the level of competition. I've gone into deep waters with some monsters, and LeVar can't say the same thing.
Hey, beating Crow Crop on any month of any day of any year is impressive. I mean, I, like you, that guy was my hero growing up, and I'm still trying to figure out how to throw that left kick that high. I can't quite get it down, but beating that guy,
You
have to realize, Brendan, from my seat, it's easy to throw out there. From your seat, it's not, because you actually have to go in there and do that. So
yeah, right.
I have to put it in perspective. I do want to ask you one more thing as we wrap this up, just because
sure.
I'm a geek and a nerd and I really like this show. There are two things that I'm fascinated with, but yet I don't want to be a part of them. I love sharks. I don't want to swim with them. I don't want to get in a cage and get in the ocean and be around them. I'm just fascinated by them. The other is ghost. I don't want a ghost at my house. I don't particularly want to go on a ghost hunt, but I believe you were on an episode of Ghost Adventures, were you not?
I was. Zach Baggins is a good buddy, and Ghost Adventures, you know, those guys are crazy what they do, where
they are.
Find the most haunted places, you know, all around the world, and they do the lockdown, stay the night there, and they invited me to one I really didn't know what I was getting into, and it was a strange experience, to say the least.
Yeah, he provokes it. I mean, I'm surprised you signed up for that. I would not, because Zach really wants to make them angry, and that just is not suitable for me.
I'd be lying to you guys if I slept with my light on that night. I was terrified, man. I'll admit that. I was terrified.
Hey, we've been watching you since The Ultimate Fighter, been rooting for you. You're a really nice guy to do this, and we always like catching up with you. Best of luck on Saturday night against LeVar Johnson, and we hope to talk to you down the road.
Hey, thanks, guys. I really appreciate the support.
All right, thanks, Brendan.
Take care.
Brendan Schaub, he'll be on UFC 157 in Anaheim this Saturday against LeVar Johnson, which will be the final card on the prelims, which is on FX.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that'll be free. So
yeah.
If you have FX, absolutely, which most people do, you can watch that fight.
He's into the main event on the FX card.
Yes. Yes, he's the main event on the FX card. And while we joked, it's true. These two are probably not going to see the second round.
No.
It will be exciting.
I mean, he can go to the second round, but it's not going to go to the decisions. It's not going to happen.
We appreciate him joining us. We need to take a break, and we're excited to also say, you know what, let's make somebody else a winner again. Order the card this weekend, UFC 157. It kicks off at 9 o'clock, but we have UFC 139 to give away on DVD. It's very simple. The first one to jump in there at 737-1025, 737-1025, will win a copy of UFC 139 on DVD. We'll take a break, and we'll be back with more. Back here, 8:35 is the time. MMA Tonight, 102.5 The Game. We were telling our ghost stories during the break. Really good to catch up with Brendan Schaub, as you can tell. Fun guy, likable guy, and really good fighter. It'll be exciting. Somebody's going down on Saturday night between him and LeVar Johnson, and hopefully he can end his two-fight losing streak and beat LeVar Johnson on Saturday night in Anaheim. Right now on the college basketball hardwoods in Lexington, Kentucky leads Vanderbilt 57-45 midway through the second half. Congratulations to Jason in Brentwood. He correctly picked up the phone and dialed 737-1025 faster than anybody else, because I saw the lines. They were going nuts. But Jason from Brentwood was the first one to jump in there and win a copy of UFC 139. Be listening. Who knows? We may give another one away before we get out of here at 9 o'clock. A couple of news and notes to pass along, Chris, before we jump into some other things that have happened in the sport with the card coming up, some of the cards that we've had recently. Big news today, Dana White and the UFC announcing that they made several cuts, and one of them was a pretty big name, actually a really big name.
John Fitch.
Yes.
Yeah. And look, a lot of people are shocked by it, and they're, you know, he doesn't deserve to be cut. And you know what? They're probably right, even though he's only won one of his last four fights. But the thing is, and the UFC knows this, they know which fighters draw fans. They know which fighters get pay-per-views bought, you know. And, you know, John Fitch has been around a long time, probably had a pretty good pay rate. And they probably looked at it and said, listen, the guy's won one of his last four fights. He's certainly, him and Dana have had some disagreements. He's not the most exciting fighter in the world. And they made a decision to cut him. I mean, people will, like purists will say, well, that's just not fair. And they're probably right. But you know what? You know, like they say, life isn't fair. The UFC will keep guys around, you know, maybe like a Brendan, like even if Brendan Schaub lost this weekend, it was an exciting fight, or Pat Barry, who does lose from time to time. His fights are always fun. People want to watch them. They tune in for them. They have good ratings. You know, those guys stay around because fans want to see them. John Fitch, I'm sure, has a lot of fans, but he's certainly not one of the most popular guys in the UFC or in that division. He's, you know, and it's just one of those things. The UFC's going to cut 100 fighters this year, they said, you know, to get their roster down from like 250 to 150. So it's just kind of part of it. And
which,
you know,
tells you they are going to cut back for sure on their cards. I mean, and they've already been doing that
and they have
to a degree.
Yeah, they have to. So, you know, John's a great fighter. He really is. You know, his style is not for me. It's not something I enjoy watching. Like, I don't enjoy watching George St. Pierre. But it doesn't mean that he's not a great fighter and people don't, and other people don't like to watch it. It's just not for me.
So what does he do? I mean, where does he go
from Bellator.
Here?
He'll probably go to Bellator.
And you know what? He'll probably end up back in the UFC.
He could. I mean, you know, he'll go to Bellator, and Bellator's got their thing going on, Spike. They've got, you know, their own reality show they're doing with, you know, Frank Shamrock and Randy Couture. And, you know, that's where fighters can go and fight and not make nearly as much money, but make money and have some exposure. And if they get on a streak, you know, they can always come back.
Let's talk about UFC on Fuel TV.
No, I don't want to.
I know. That's the problem. I mean, if we're going to get these free fights and we're getting them on FX and Fox, I don't know the numbers, Chris, but I pride myself in having a lot of options at home. I thought every channel possible. Mm-hmm. Well, come to find out, I don't have Fuel TV. How many people have Fuel TV in Middle Tennessee, and how many have Fuel TV in the country? Do you have any sort of numbers out there? I mean, what are the percentages? I remember when ESPN threw out ESPN2, and very few people had it. And I remember what they started to do, and I think that's what Dana White and the UFC is trying to do. Remember, they would every once in a while they would put Duke and North Carolina on ESPN2, and everybody's screaming, "What? You're putting Duke, North Carolina on ESPN2? We don't have ESPN2." And so everybody calls up their cable provider and says, "What are you doing? You know, why don't you have ESPN2? I need to watch Duke, North Carolina. There's this big college basketball game, and you don't provide me with that channel." And so eventually the outcry changed the cable providers to pick up that channel. Is that what they're trying to do with Fuel TV? Because I don't know anybody who has Fuel TV.
All right. Okay, so here's the story. So Fuel TV is obviously a Fox network, and Fuel TV was part of the package with the UFC. And Fuel TV is on DirecTV and on Dish Network. It's not on Comcast or Time Warner Cable, et cetera, et cetera. But let me get to that. So when the UFC and the Fox got into an agreement, Fox said, okay, well, this is a way that we can brand Fuel TV and kind of turn it into a kind of replace what Versus was, because that's what it did, right? So,
but I had Versus.
Right, exactly. So now most people were hoping that this would happen in September of last year, that they would Comcast would pick it up. That was the earliest they could do it and pick it up, because we definitely missed a lot of good UFC fights. And quite honestly, MMA Tonight on Fuel TV is really good. Ariel Helwani's on, has a lot of great interviews, a lot of breaking news. So we're missing a lot of good stuff. Well, they announced last week that they've come in agreement with Comcast. And so Comcast will be adding Fuel TV. I don't remember when, but I'm assuming it's going to be soon. Fox and Comcast came to an agreement. And
like before March 3rd or on March 3rd?
I don't know. I haven't read. You can use the Google and look that up.
Because I want to see that card in Japan.
I'll look it up and tweet it out later. If you want to follow me on Twitter, it's at Nashville_MMA. But I got a release from the UFC about it, so I'll post that out. Sorry, my elbow knocked me off. But so, I mean, it worked, because I don't think Fuel TV would have been picked up by Comcast if they didn't have UFC programming. And that's probably where Comcast got the letters and the emails and said, you know, they do pull some ratings, and it could certainly add to their revenue, because they could put advertising. Comcast gets to put their local advertising on Fuel TV during UFC fight. So, you know, it worked out, and it just took a little longer than maybe we wanted, but you should be able to start seeing the UFC fight soon.
Yeah, this last weekend, that card I thought was crap.
Yeah, it was.
I mean, listen,
I don't like to call it crap, because he's a professional fighter.
No, I understand. But
it wasn't a fight that I was really looking to watch.
It was not attractive to me. I'll just leave it at that, okay? But the card in Japan on March the 3rd on Fuel, I absolutely want to see. Vanderlei Silva, Brian Stann.
Yeah.
On the main, for the light heavyweight.
Yeah.
On the main card, you've got Mark Hunt and Stefan Struve.
Yeah.
Diego Sanchez is on that card. Yushin Okami. I absolutely want to see that card, and I don't get the feeling, even though they've agreed to terms, that we're going to have it by March 3rd. I hope I'm wrong.
Well, I mean, you know, I don't know how long it would take, you know, for them to add the channel. I don't know that, but I'm sure that they – it hasn't been announced yet. I'm sure that they are aware that there's a pretty good fight coming up on Fuel that the UFC would like to have on more than just the DirecTV channel. So I'm sure if they can do it and if they, you know, drafted the agreement appropriately that they could do it, that they will. And if they don't, you know, life goes on. You'll catch the next one, you know. But
are you intrigued as much about Vanderlei and Stan as me?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think those are two fun, exciting fighters, and people like to see that. And, you know, I think it's more of a, you know, Brian Stann has more to lose than Vanderlei because Brian Stann's still in the picture. Vanderlei never will be again in that division. But if Stann can come out and knock out Vanderlei, you know, be fun. But, you know, Vanderlei's always comes to fight. I mean, that guy's a warrior. I mean, you know, he's like Rampage. You may not like Rampage, but he does come and try, and he does come swinging. And, you know, what's amazing about Rampage is he's never been knocked. He hasn't been knocked out in a long time, if he ever has been. I know he got knocked out by Slam once, but yeah, somehow he hasn't gone down either. So
we'll take our final break, and it'll be very advantageous for you to be listening through the break and be listening to the final segment. I'll just leave it at that. Also, check out Pro MMA Now, that website. Jack Bratcher and that crew do a really good job every day of covering the sport, putting up the news and notes that follow mixed martial arts, including this hour. They put up our MMA Tonight hour every week. And if you miss the interviews, we've had some really good interviews lately. We had Brendan Schaub today or tonight. Last week we had Benson Henderson. He was tremendous. The week before that was Sean Jordan, and he was great. It's been one after another, and I think these are interviews, if you follow the sport and you like the sport, you would really like to listen to. So check out Pro MMA Now, and we appreciate all the work that Jack Bratcher does. We'll take our final break, come back, and wrap up the show next here on 102.5 The Game. Final segment, 8:49 is the time on this Wednesday night, MMA Tonight. 102.5 The Game, Darren McFarland, Chris Pappas with you every Wednesday night following Slapshot Radio right here on 102.5.
Go Preds.
Yeah. Big win last night.
That's right.
In Detroit. Or not in Detroit.
My former employer.
At Bridgestone Arena.
Yeah, my former employer.
That's right. Long time ago. A little bit different franchise.
A little bit, but the same coach is there.
This is when you were employed by them.
Same coach is there now.
Yeah, which, by the way, congratulations to him, because today he became the longest tenured coach in the National Hockey League.
How about that, huh?
Lindy Ruff,
the National Predators
boot.
Coach. What, 22 sellouts now coming up?
21, yeah. But yeah, it'll be 22 because they'll sell out Friday night against the Knuckleheads.
It's a hockey town.
It is a hockey town. Pretty cool to see that atmosphere in there night in and night out. A couple of college basketball scores to pass along. Alabama leads Mississippi State 52-43 with about 3.5 to go in that contest. Texas A&M up by a bucket over Auburn, 55-53 with 3 minutes to go. And currently in Lexington at Rupp Arena, Vanderbilt is on a big-time run. They've been trailing pretty much by double digits most of the time since I've been watching, which has been a while since the first half. Kentucky now only leads 61-59 with 350 to go in that one. So, wow, this thing may come down to the wire.
SEC basketball. Kind of rough this year, Darren.
Yeah, it's
the Vols are playing better. I'm happy about that.
I wouldn't say it's
a good game with
fever.
It's a good game to the Vols and your Wildcats last week.
Yeah, thanks for bringing that up.
Sure, no problem.
Belmont defeats Eastern Illinois 80-49, and right now Tennessee State up by 10 over SIU Edwardsville 75-65, about just under 5 minutes to go in that game. UFC 139, really good card. It's on DVD. It's free. Don't forget to order UFC 157 this weekend, starting at 9 o'clock is when the pay-per-view card will start. The prelims before then, we just talked about it. Brendan Schaub's fight will be on FX. But UFC 139 on DVD, it was a really good card. You can see the likes of Shogun and Dan Henderson, Vandalay Silva and Kong Lee. Those are some good matchups. Uriah Faber, Martin Kampman, Stefan Bonner, all on this card. And the first person to pick up the phone and dial 737-1025. One more, Parker.
I've been
you've been working the phones back there. 737-1025. First person. Let's do three.
All right.
How about caller three? Because they've been blowing up. So let's do caller three for UFC 139. So jump in there and be a winner. Speaking of Uriah Faber, isn't it amazing? This is what I love about the sport, because we've seen it evolve where we go through these times when there are certain fighters that look invincible, they can't lose, and they're on a hot streak, and you're wondering, is there anybody that can beat this person? Who could possibly be their next opponent? And then, Chris, they can't win fights anymore, or you know, they win one and they lose the next three. I mean, it's amazing. That is the part of the intrigue, or the, I guess, hitch of following mixed martial arts, because of the uncertainty.
Well, and you know what happens too, is a lot of guys like Uriah Faber are a little bit ahead of their time, and which is a testament to them. But then their division or their weight class, fighters get more talented and it becomes tougher. And, you know, Uriah Faber is not going out there and, you know, getting beat by tomato cans, and he's not losing, you know, quickly.
He was on a 13 fight win streak before he lost to Mike Brown.
Yeah, no, he's
twice.
Yeah, he's you know, he's still a great fighter, but
you're right. He's lost to Dominic Cruz. Sure. I mean,
he's in his early 30s now.
Jose Aldo. These are not tomato cans. These are the who's who in that division.
Yeah, I mean, that happens. You know, having to Miguel Torres. It happens when some guys you think they're unbeatable, and then the sport catches up with them a little bit. And then it becomes a little tougher. In talking about what we talked about earlier about, you know, we're talking about downtown and predators and stuff, you know, now that Nashville is building that, I call it the mothership. It looks like what I think.
I was just down there. I mean, it's incredible.
That's what I think would happen if aliens took over the Earth. They would land something like that on our planet.
Our convention center.
It is massive. You know, the UFC told me directly, you know, that right there will, you know, pretty much guarantee us to have a large pay-per-view or a Fox card, maybe even a UFC fan expo. So, you know, as I'm sure it'll help with the NHL All-Star game and et cetera.
Absolutely.
But, you know, this is a big
Frozen
market.
Four.
Yeah, this is the big market for MMA and for the UFC and for all the fans out there. You know, they keep asking me on Twitter and when I'm saying, you know, when are we going to get a big card? Well, I think you'll see it, you know, if not later this year, for sure next year.
And that's a good point, because all we've had, and I think, while that's great, I think it's pretty clear we're ready to graduate from the fight cards. We're ready to move up to the big boy land. FedEx Forum got one in Memphis. They sold it out. But we need a pay-per-view card. And with a convention center like that that's about to open in late May, early June of 2013, this year, it's hard to believe, right? We're about 3 months away from that sucker opening up.
It's amazing.
It's going to change our city forever.
Hope we're building more hotels.
And they are, including bringing, you know, hopefully a pay-per-view card, a monster pay-per-view card to Nashville where they can sell out Bridgestone Arena.
Yeah. Or Fox card, you know.
Have a big event. Well, yeah, some very, really, really good. I mean,
not a fight night card.
No.
We had two of those.
We had Cain Velasquez on a Fox card.
Yeah.
Right? And Junior Dos Santos. That was a Fox card.
Oh,
we'll take something like that.
All the Fox cards have been huge now because they figured it out. I mean, they're big cards.
How do you think that's going, by the way, as we wrap this up?
The ratings are very, very good. Very good. You know, there are some people that...
So Fox is happy, UFC's happy.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking about, you know, an average of 3.6 million or so people, with a peak during the big cards of over 5 million. I mean, on a Saturday night when nothing else is really on to keep people around, I think that's good. You know, it wins, obviously, the night across the board. And, you know, I think it does what they want. I think it will only grow. You know, I'm sure there's some people that think it should be more and some people, you know, think it's unreal. But I think it's very good, and I think they're very happy.
All right, Rousey win.
Oh, yeah. It wouldn't be hard. It'd be, you know, it'd be like Michael Jordan, you know, playing you in one-on-one.
Well, I don't think I wouldn't beat him that badly.
Even at age 50. I mean, y'all are similar ages, so it's fine.
Mm-hmm. Well, Cheetah and Dan Henderson, who wins?
You know, I don't know. I've always said that Machida is a kind of an overrated fighter, and when I say that, I don't mean I think he's a bad fighter. I think people for a time there thought he was unbeatable and all this crazy stuff. I think Hendo wins, to be honest with you. I think Hendo wins by decision, because I don't think Henderson's dumb enough to do things that some fighters have done and just walk in with their arms wide open with Machida and get knocked out. I think Hendo is a smart guy. He's got that overhand right. Machida's got to respect the wrestling. Machida's got to respect. It's going to be tough for him to get inside. So I think Hendo wins by decision.
Faber bounce back and win?
Yeah, I mean, he's fighting a tough guy, though. I mean, but, yeah, I think
I don't know
will.
Much about this guy.
I think he'll win by a decision.
It's Ivan Drago?
That sounds good.
No, I'm kidding. That was from Rocky.
Yeah, I take Faber.
Court McGee wins, and Josh Koscheck.
I think Koscheck should win that fight.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks, as always.
No, thank you.
Congratulations to Derek and McEwen. And Jason and Gallatin. We gave away two? Okay, Parker feeling really generous back there. Appreciate everybody's participation. Thanks to Brendan Schaub for calling in. Remember, every Wednesday night from 8 to 9, it's MMA Tonight. Have a great night. We'll talk to you tomorrow, 102.5 The Game.